Well, friends, good morning and welcome to First Presbyterian Church of Morristown, New Jersey on this beautiful Pentecost Sunday. We're delighted that you have joined us here in Miller Commons. Those of you who have joined us via live stream, we welcome all of you in the name of Christ. Pentecost is all about new beginnings brought forth by God's love. Today marks the day when the Holy Spirit was unleashed upon God's people and upon the church. That includes this congregation, and that very much includes your lives as well. As we celebrate Pentecost today, we express our gratitude for the faithfulness of Jesus as he has fulfilled his promise to send to us another advocate, another counselor, another comforter. Please register your attendance if you haven't yet done so on our Church Center app. If you have it on your phone, it's really easy to do. Please do so if you're watching via live stream. If you need help and you're here, you can go out into our Commons lobby, and one of our deacons will be happy to help you. So friends, we are still in the higher levels of with our COVID numbers according to the CDC. So we do respectfully request that you wear masks today. And I thank you for your cooperation and your help. So our summer worship hours begin today, and they will be in effect through all of the summer until Labor Day weekend. Our traditional worship service in the sanctuary is at 9 o'clock. This contemporary service in Miller Commons at 10:30. We have coffee hour, and thankfully we can still do that even with higher numbers. The coffee hour happens in the courtyard between the Commons lobby and the sanctuary. So if you're coming to this service, come a little bit early. We've got goodies. We've got a lot. We are looking for volunteers. If you're able to help get some of the bagels beforehand, you just have to go to Maple Shade to get them. Pretty easy to do. Also, we just need volunteers for the table. If you can help in your worship guides or on our website, you can find a way to reach out to Lissa Herman or to Sue Piper. Throughout this summer, we're collecting a number of things, and there's a drop-off center in our Commons lobby. These will go to various local mission partners. So we're looking for things like rice, box milk, proteins, cleaning supplies, paper products, school supplies, sports equipment, and children and adult books. The drop-off can happen anytime from now through the end of the summer. VBS is coming. It's the last week of June from 9 in the morning until noon. June 16th is the last day for you to register. You can do so only online. We still do need some adult and teen volunteers. Well, friends, it's Pentecost Sunday, which means that we get to worship God together and receive the Holy Spirit together as well. So let's stand and let's worship God together.
This is one of those songs where you can join us by clapping with us. So we're going to be going like this. There you go. Eric's got it.
Raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. Raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. I'm from beyond.
heavens are your tabernacle.
Good morning. I don't often get to come out from hiding behind the piano. Jesus promised his disciples that he would send a counselor, the Spirit of Truth, to them. This Spirit would remain with his friends forever. That same promise holds true for we who follow Jesus today. The Holy Spirit fills the world and knows every word, thought, and deed of ours. Let us then open ourselves to the Lord and confess our sins with humility and faith. Let's start by offering our own personal prayers in silence. Let us pray. Amen. My friends in Christ, can you bottle a breeze? Can you blow out a forest fire? Can you help but breathe? For those times we stifle your spirit, O God. For those times we ignore your whispers and shouts. For those times when we turn away from your wonders and miracles, forgive us. The breeze is loosed on the world. The fire is consumed. We breathe deeply, for indeed, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Hear and trust these certain words. God's Spirit did not leave us after that first Pentecost. The Spirit is still with us, empowering us to know mercy and grace, forgiveness and service. In this Spirit and through Christ, we proclaim the good news. We are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. We can be certain today that we belong to God's family, every one of us. Now, let's now welcome those around us with a wave of the hand, a fist bump, or a pat on the back. And as you greet those near you, remember to do more than say good morning. Forgive and bless each other too.
Hey, Mark, how are you? Well, it's just so exciting to celebrate Pentecost together. For our celebration this morning, we have a blending of passages that recount the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the disciples in Jerusalem with a description of the Spirit's work within our lives and our congregation. As Leslie and I read, members and friends from our congregation will set candles on the communion table, reminding us that the Holy Spirit filled and then used the lives of ordinary men, women, young adults, and children, just like us.
When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place.
They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Rachel, I invite you and your daughters to come and set the candle on the communion table. You can take your mask off. They're all doing nice.
Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting.
The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Bethany, I invite you to come and place your candle on the table.
They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them.
See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly, the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come to you. Jonathan, I invite you to set your candle.
All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them.
You were slain, Lamb of God, and with your blood you purchased saints for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. Dave, I invite you to come and set your candle.
Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking in his own language.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Eric, I invite you to set your candle.
Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?
How can they call on one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?" Jacob, I invite you to set your candle.
This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people.
And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Karen, I invite you to set your candle.
And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Carrie, I invite you to come and set your candle. The day of Pentecost is a beautiful and grand day for us today. The Spirit of God overtook 120 disciples in Jerusalem. The Spirit of God also today overtakes us. Those 120 were as ordinary as you feel. In the gift of the Holy Spirit, the ongoing presence of God overtakes us. We are no longer orphans in this world. We are not wanderers in a very cold world anymore. We are not left to wonder now about what is our destiny because we already know it. We have already seen it among us in the person of Jesus and in the faces of these sisters and brothers who stand before us. Today, we begin to see not only what we are, but what we can be. Will you pray with me for yourself and for our church? Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Melt me. Mold me. Fill me. Use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me and on us. For Jesus' sake, amen. Friends, thank you for your help. You may be seated. As Ben leads us in another worship song, we're in our offering time, and you are welcome to place your offering in the box there. You're also welcome to write a prayer request on the table. And you're also welcome to give Sam a big round of applause for working so hard. This is the hardest working man in our church. In our church. Thanks, Sam. So just before we go to a time of worship and offering, a letter of well-wishing that we'll be sending out today is going to Becca Niendorf's Aunt Shirley. She's been diagnosed with abdominal cancer and is now undergoing chemotherapy treatment in the hopes of shrinking the tumor that it may be removed from her. So Becca would really welcome your prayers for her Aunt Shirley, that God would sustain her and heal her in this time. I share with you the sad news that Rich Myers died on Thursday morning. Rich and Nancy have been long-time members of this church. Their family has been a precious part of this congregation. For years, Rich served as a part of our property team. And Rich just had a number of health concerns. As of today, there is no word on the arrangements for Rich's memorial or funeral service. Once we know that, we will gladly and promptly share that with you. Would you pray for the Myers this morning? Rich and Nancy were often here, and I know how much Rich, in his strong faith for the Lord Jesus, loved to worship God. And a word of joy, thanksgiving, and praise. Strawberry Festival on Friday night was absolutely amazing. I know probably all of you were there, or at least not most of you were. And it was just a beautiful evening God gave us. And I have no idea how many people were here. I just know that our grounds were filled with folks from our church, friends of our church. But to me, what was the most exciting thing was I had no idea who most of the people were. Lots of families, lots of young people, lots of just faces from our community. I thank God for that. I had been praying that God would use Friday evening, and I believe that God really did. So we give thanks to God for our Strawberry Festival. Special word of thanks to three women who did so much to make it happen. Lori LaMonica, Jen Allen, and Kristen Perkowski were the primary organizers of that, with a lot of volunteer help, including many people in this room. And our property team, Sam, who was just in here, these guys have been working so hard this weekend under the direction of Steve Marjoram. So when you see them, thank them. Let's worship God.
Stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him. As heaven looked away, the Son of God was laid in darkness. Battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled.
Your tears.
sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah.
They were in a handmade wooden boat, a boat that would just about fit inside Miller Commons. The boat was about 26 and a half feet in length, 7.5 feet wide, 4.5 feet high. There were 13 men in the boat, Jesus and his 12 disciples. Remember that of the 12 disciples, at least 7 were professional fishermen. They knew the waters of the Lake of Galilee well after years of working on its waters. They knew that storms, particularly in the evening, could arise suddenly and violently as this storm did that they were now facing. Such strong squalls were nicknamed by the fishermen of Galilee. They called them sharkeia storms, shark storms, because these storms were vicious and dangerous. It was evening, and darkness encompassed the boat quickly. They were far from shore, and the shark storm was getting worse. They might drown. They knew. Incredibly, Jesus was fast asleep in the boat in the middle of it all. The disciples, including all 7 professional fishermen, were terrified by the storm. And when you get a sense of what that might look like, this is a pretty good depiction of that. You can understand their terror. They were also incredulous that Jesus could be asleep in the middle of such a storm. In his classic book on prayer, Learning to Pray, Anthony Bloom notes something significant that happened to the frightened men in the boat that night. He writes, "And then at a certain moment, the disciples lose heart, and the storm that was outside comes inside. The storm is within them, too. Anguish, death, no longer simply circle around them. They come inside them. The storm that was outside comes inside. Hasn't this happened to so many of us over the last couple years of the pandemic? The storm of disruption and uncertainty, and with that, fear and anger and discouragement, storm winds circling around us, have they not come inside us? Overactivity in the form of ceaseless busyness, painful loneliness and isolation and deep anxiety seem to reside in us. I know that I need some super strength inside me to overcome the shark storm that now seems to dominate my life, my thinking, and my emotions. On this Pentecost Sunday, I'm here to declare to you that this super strength that you need is the love of God. The Holy Spirit delivers this powerful love to you today. God's love was at the center of a prayer that the Apostle Paul prayed for his friends in the Ephesus church. This divine love is at the center of God's master plan for your life and for this congregation. I pray this prayer for you this morning. Our scripture lesson today comes from the book of Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. As you hear God's word today, his word is certain and reliable. Consider a thought from a German philosopher. All of us need more love than we deserve. All of us need more love than we deserve. That's true for me. I'm going to guess that that's true for you. So listen to the word of God as it's found in Ephesians chapter 3, beginning with verse 14. When I think of all this, I fall to my knees and pray to the Father, the creator of everything in heaven and on earth. I pray that from his glorious unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his Spirit. Then Christ will make his home in your hearts as you trust in him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. Now, all glory to God, who is able, through his mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. Glory to him in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Would you pray with me for the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ our Lord? Let us pray. Lord, you once promised your servant Jeremiah that you would take the hearts of your people, hearts that are often as hard as granite, and you would make them hearts of flesh. You told Jeremiah that you would write your word on their hearts. You promised, Lord, that you would give us ears to hear you speak. Lord, would you do all of these things today for us? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts, may they be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Paul prayed this prayer that I just read for you in a prison. In a prison cell, dark, cold, and hopeless, Paul prayed. Perhaps there was a shaft of light shining on a wall, reminding Paul that God's love is strong enough to break into the gloom of a prison cell or to a heart filled with a storm. Kneeling, which was an unusual way for a Jewish man to pray, people in that time stood and prayed with hands open and heads turned up to heaven. But Paul put himself in a position of total vulnerability, kneeling, where he could not run but only surrender. And from there he prayed this: Father, out of your honorable and glorious riches, strengthen your people. Fill their souls with the power of your Spirit, so that through faith the Lord Jesus will reside in their hearts. May love be the rich soil where their lives take root. May it be the bedrock where their lives are founded, so that together with all of your people, they will have the power to understand that the love of Jesus is infinitely long, wide, high, and deep, surpassing everything anyone previously experienced. God, may your fullness flood through their entire beings. At the center of this prayer in verse 17 is where Paul asks that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, or that Christ will be more and more at home in your hearts as you trust in him. The Greek word that Paul uses to dwell is a word that should bring to your minds today a sense of permanence. In this sense, we say that Jesus does not come as a visitor. Jesus does not pay rent. No, Jesus comes as the owner of the home where he will stay forever. In Spanish, the response is, mi casa es su casa, which means, your home is my home. My home is your home. Which is a way of saying that every part of your home, every chair, every staircase, every book, every morsel of food is available to the one who comes to your home, to Jesus. It's also likely that the language of God's Spirit filling or dwelling with glory in this prayer and in Ephesians is a phrase that connects the Old Testament's descriptions of the glory of God that wondrously, in an awe-inspiring way, filled temples and tabernacles. And people watched with amazement at as the glory of God filled those spaces. And now Paul prays that the glory of God would fill our ordinary lives with the same Spirit of God. So it is this permanent love brought to us by Jesus, driven into our lives by the Holy Spirit, that drives out the storms within us. Now, this may not be difficult to understand. It is difficult to believe. Author David Benner offers a simple exercise. Here it is. Imagine God thinking about you. What do you assume God feels when you come to mind? When God thinks about you, what do you assume comes to God's mind? David Benner says most people honestly answer disappointment. They assume that when God thinks about them, God feels disappointed in them. Here's how someone answered that question. Deep down, I assume God's initial response to me is mostly disappointment. Sure, God loves me, but mainly I think he does that in spite of his disappointment over my sin. His love just barely peeks through the cracks of the blanket of my mess-ups. I am encouraged to accept God's love, and I think, well, if I can just stop hurting God, stop disappointing him so much, I'll be able to feel his love more. So I better get my life together because I know that this love of God thing is a big deal. So here's a real question. How do I trust perfect love? Better yet, how do I experience it? Because really, we can intellectually know something all that we want, but it won't affect change unless we experience it. How many times have you heard that God loves you? I can't number them. But I admit to you today that I struggle to trust that this is true. I'll acknowledge that I have a very hard time saying that I experience what I believe to be true. I have a hard time experiencing that as the center of my life. Because I too believe that God is mostly disappointed with me as a disciple, as a pastor, as a husband, as a father. I do believe God loves me, but I admit that sometimes it seems like nothing changes. In his book, Surrender to Love, Christian psychologist David Benner writes this: the reason nothing changes is that the focus is still on me. My failures, my remorse, my discouragement, my effort or lack thereof. Love requires leaving all this behind, all of my self preoccupation. Love requires leaving that all behind. The Message paraphrases verse 18 beautifully. Listen to this. I ask God the Father that you'll be able to take in with all Christians the extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. Reach out and experience its breadth. Test its length, plumb its depths, rise to the heights, live full lives, full of the fullness of God. All of us need more love than we deserve. All of us get that love through the gift of the Holy Spirit, who personally delivers that love to the depths of your life, so that Jesus Christ resides in your heart forever. Then we understand this. The point of God's love is to remake us into the image of love. God wants us to make his life our life, his heart ours, his love ours. God wants us to be like God. He wants our lives to be characterized by his love. That's why we are loved. The storms of life easily move into us. The love of God resists those storms. And in turn, the love of God moves us to combat the storms that rage all around us right now in our nation and in our world, filled with God's certain love. We love back, which means we push back against the hatred and fear that now storms throughout our nation and world. Filled with God's certain love, we open our own lives and the doors of this church to all of those who feel unloved and scorned. There's a professional surfer from Germany named Sebastian Steinert. He recently surfed what's considered to be the highest wave ever surfed, 85 feet. He did so on a surfboard off the waters of Nazaré, Portugal. In describing catching this wave, he said this: I knew it. He said, I got to get on this wave now. So he nodded toward his jet ski driver, and he held on to his tow rope as he was towed into this monster wave that was looming over him. He said, I'll never forget what I saw when I started to drop behind the peak and saw the entire wave. Imagine. I started to accelerate like crazy. I had tears from the wind speed, and I was just holding on with everything that I had, just hanging on. You don't feel the size of an 85-foot wave. He added, you feel the power. You don't feel the size, you feel the power. You don't feel the size of God's love, you feel the power when you begin to love others like Christ. At the end of the service, we're going to hear our way of the week. And our way of this week is number 3, listen generously. It's a way that invites you this week to sit and listen to somebody and to do so with undivided attention, with full energy, nothing between you, no phones, no television on, no radio, just you with the person you love or the one you're listening to. That is one of the best ways to love someone else, to listen generously to them. Brennan Manning and his wife Rosalyn were once walking through their home city of New Orleans in the French Quarter when a young woman approached them and pinned a flower on each of their jackets. She asked the Mannings for a donation to her mission. When asked which mission, she said, the Unification Church. She was a follower of Reverend Sung Young Moon, a Korean man who began this large church that most scholars would consider to be a dangerous cult. She was also known in those days as a Mooney. Brennan Manning, a committed follower of Christ, had two thoughts immediately after this brief encounter with the young woman. First, he thought, this young woman is a lost pagan. Secondly, he thought she was a naive child who had been brainwashed. Now, based on those two thoughts, he could have done a couple of things. He could have angrily scolded her or fearfully turned and walked away from her. Instead, out of a place of deep love, a love he couldn't see but he could feel as he loved this girl in front of him, he said, expressing admiration, that she was walking the streets of New Orleans doing something she really believed in. He affirmed her for that. You are, he said, a challenge to anyone who claims the name of Christ. The young woman asked the Mannings if they were Christians. Yes, they said. She lowered her head and she began crying. I've been on my mission here in the French Quarter for 8 days now. You're the first Christians who have been nice to me. The others have looked at me with contempt or screamed at me and told me that I'm possessed by a demon. One Christian woman hit me with her Bible. In Christ, we live a life of love filled with a power that is greater than an 85-foot wave off of the coast of Portugal. This love is delivered personally to us by the Holy Spirit, and it is, I assure you, greater than every single storm that rages inside of you today. For this reason, we are blessed to come to the Lord's table today. I'm going to invite the band to come and take their places as we prepare to worship God as we receive the elements of bread and cup. And we do have communion serving kits. There are some on the table. If you need one, please be sure to have one with you. Friends, the Lord God, in the fullness of Christ's promise, poured out the Holy Spirit upon the chosen disciples and filled the church that day and today with power. We thank you, Lord, for sending your Spirit to us to kindle faith and to lead us into all truth, working in this church to make us faithful, loving disciples. So, Spirit of God, Counselor and Comforter, would you come near to us today with forgiveness that heals and boldness to love you and all people and to live today, Lord, with a confidence we may have never had before that your love is for us, that we are loved by Christ who dwells within us forever. Friends, I invite you to come today to feed in your heart by faith upon Christ. For I received of the Lord that which I delivered also unto you, that on the night he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and having blessed it, he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Take, eat in remembrance of me." After the supper, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant shed for the forgiveness of sins. Drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do declare the Lord's death until he comes." Would you pray with me? Lord, thank you for this table, for the gifts that are now ours to receive and to ingest into our lives. Thank you for your love, your powerful, powerful love. Would you pour that into our lives today and into our church? Spirit of God, please move over these gifts and your people today, setting us aside from the common to the sacred use that you intend. Friends, the body of Christ given for you, broken for you. Take, eat in remembrance of him. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take, drink in remembrance of him.
My King, to know you in your
And oh, I want to know you deeper than before. Oh, I want to know you more and more. And oh, I want to know.
Hi, my name is Brian Gaskill, and I'm a member here at FPC Morristown. Hi, my name is Brian Gaskill, and I'm a member here at FPC Morristown. Way number three, listen generously. Be quick to listen and do so with your undivided attention. Minimize distractions and let go of the need to agree or disagree. Suspend your judgment and be curious to know more rather than jumping to conclusions. Above all, listen to understand. I'm grateful for this way because I feel that it's applicable to my everyday life in both my faith journey and as well as my school journey. I feel that it really has helped me to grow within the past few years. By listening generously, I'm able to understand more and to really apply it to my daily life. I believe that this way is important for our church because it helps to create an environment and where conversation can be held without judgment. By minimizing our distractions, we're able to grow closer with God and understand what He wants us to be doing with our life and how our relationship should be with Him. I've practiced this way through my Discovery Bible study. By reading scripture and really listening without distractions, it allows me to focus on what God wants me to hear and focuses me on understanding how I can accomplish that in my daily life. A suggestion I have for how you can really integrate this way into your life is by setting aside time where you can be distraction-free and really focus on, whether it be scripture or prayer, just growing closer to God without distractions for a certain amount of time. I like to set aside 15 minutes, 30 minutes, and really just focus in on what God wants me to hear and how I can carry that out in my life. And that is way number three. Listen generously.
Ken, if you want to put hands on shoulders, you can. What I would ask you to do is to pray for the lives on either side of you and our congregation. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you, first of all, for this morning, for this worship, for this table, Lord, for the gifts of today and this Pentecost Sunday. And we thank you for this church. And we pray, the Spirit of God, that you would indeed fill us and send us forth to be as generous in loving others as we have been generously loved by you. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord's face shine with joy because of you. And may the Lord look deeply into your eyes and grant you peace. And may that peace which surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and your minds at rest in Christ Jesus, both now and forevermore. Amen.